Hello everyone, welcome to System Software and Compilers Module 3 lecture video. In this lecture, we will be learning about the role of parser and representative grammars. Syntax analysis. Syntax analysis is about parsing methods that are typically used in compilers. We will be learning about the basic concepts, then the techniques suitable for hand implementation, and the algorithms that have been used in automated tools. Since programs may contain syntactic errors, we also see the parsing methods for recovery from common errors. With reference to the design of languages, every programming language has precise rules that prescribe the syntactic structure of well-formed programs. In C language, for example, a program is made up of functions. A function is made up of declarations and statements. And a statement is made up of expressions and so on. The syntax of programming language constructs can be specified by context-free grammars or BNF, that is a Backus Naur form notation. Grammars offer significant benefits for both language designers and compiler writers. A grammar gives a precise yet easy to understand syntactic specification of a programming language. From certain classes of grammars, we can construct automatically an efficient parser that determines the syntactic structure of a source program. As a side benefit, the parser construction process can reveal syntactic ambiguities and trouble spots that might have slipped through the initial design phase of a language. The structure imparted to a language by a properly designed grammar is useful for translating a source program into correct object code and for detecting errors. A grammar allows a language to be evolved or developed iteratively by adding new constructs to perform new tasks. These new constructs can be integrated more easily into an implementation that follows the grammatical structure of the language. Now, we examine how the parser fits into a typical compiler. We then look at typical grammars for arithmetic expressions. Grammars for expressions are sufficient for illustrating the essence of parsing, since parsing techniques for expressions carry over to most programming constructs. In the compiler model, the parser obtains a string of tokens from a lexical analyzer and verifies that the string of token names can be generated by the grammar for the source language. We expect the parser to report any syntax errors in an intelligible fashion and to recover from commonly occurring errors to continue the processing the remainder of the program. Conceptually, for well-formed programs, the parser constructs a parse tree. Parser constructs a parse tree and passes it to the rest of the compiler for further processing. In fact, the parse tree need not be constructed explicitly, since checking and translation actions can be combined with parsing. Thus, the parser and the rest of the front end could well be implemented by a single module. There are three general types of parser for grammars. Those are universal, top-down, and bottom-up. Universal parsing methods such as the Koch-Younger-Kasami algorithm and Early's algorithm can parse any grammar. These general methods are however too inefficient to use in production compilers. The methods commonly used in compilers can be classified as being either top down or bottom up. As implied by their names, the top down methods can build the parse trees from top, that is root, to the bottom, that is leaves, while the bottom up methods start from the leaves and work their way up to the root. In either case, the input to the parser is scanned from left to right, one symbol at a time. The most efficient top-down and bottom-up methods work only for subclasses of grammars, but several of these classes, particularly LL and LR, are expressive enough to describe most of the syntactic constructs in modern programming languages. The parsers implemented by hand often use LL grammars. The predictive parsing approach works for LL grammars. Parsers for the larger class of LR grammars are usually constructed using automated tools. We assume that the output of the parser is some representation of the parse tree. For the stream of tokens that comes from the lexical analyzer. In practice, there are a number of tasks that might be conducted during parsing, such as collecting information about various tokens into the symbol table, performing type checking, and other kinds of semantic analysis, and generating intermediate code. We have combined all these activities into the rest of the front end in the figure. Let us examine some of the grammars. Constructs that begin with keywords like while or int are relatively easy to parse because the keyword guides the choice of the grammar production that must be applied to match the input. So, we concentrate on expressions which present more challenge because of the associativity and precedence of operators. Consider the grammar E derives E plus T or T derives T star F or F. F derives parenthesized E or ID. Associativity and precedence are captured in the following grammar for describing expressions as terms and factors. E represents expressions consisting of terms separated by plus signs. T represents terms consisting of factors separated by star signs, and F represents factors that can be either parenthesized expressions or identifiers. Expression grammar belongs to the class of LR grammars that are suitable for bottom-up parsing. This grammar can be adapted to handle additional operators and additional levels of precedence. However, this cannot be used for top-down parsing because it is left recursive. Now we write the non-left recursive variant of previous expression grammar, which will be used for top-down parsing. So, E derives TE dash, E dash derives plus TE dash or epsilon, T derives F T dash, T dash derives star ft dash or epsilon, and f derives parenthesized e or id. Now we write a grammar that treats plus and star similar, so it is useful for illustrating techniques for handling ambiguities during parsing. E derives E star E. E derives parenthesized E, or E derives ID. Here E represent expressions of all types. This grammar permits more than one parse tree for the expressions like id plus id star id. Now we consider the nature of syntactic errors and general strategies for error recovery. If a compiler had to process only correct programs, its design and implementation would be simplified greatly. However, a compiler is expected to assist the programmer in locating and tracking down errors that inevitably creep into the programs despite the programmer's best efforts. Strikingly, few languages have been designed with error handling in mind, even though errors are so common. Most programming language specifications do not describe how a compiler should respond to errors. Error handling is left to the compiler designer. Planning the error handling right from the start can both simplify the structure of a compiler and improve its handling of errors. Common programming errors can occur at many different levels. Common programming errors are lexical errors. Lexical errors include misspellings of identifiers, keywords, or operators. Example, the use of an identifier ellipse size instead of ellipse size, and missing quotes around text intended as a string. Syntactic errors include misplaced semicolons or extra or missing braces, that is the extra braces or missing brace. As an another example, in C or Java, the appearance of case statement without an enclosing switch is also a syntactic error. Semantic errors. Semantic errors include type mismatches between operators and operands. One example can be a return statement. Return statement in a Java method with the result type as a void. Logical errors. Logical errors are caused due to the incorrect logic used by the programmer in the program. The example for this is that the programmer has used equal to in place of comparison operator. The program containing equal to may be well formed, however, it may not reflect the programmer's intent. Several parsing methods such as the LL and LR methods detect an error as soon as possible. That is when the stream of tokens from the lexical analyzer cannot be passed further according to the grammar for the language. More precisely, they have the viable prefix property, meaning that they detect that an error has occurred as soon as they see a prefix of the input that cannot be completed to form a string in the language. Another reason for emphasizing error recovery during parsing is that many errors appear syntactic, whatever their cause, and are exposed when parsing cannot continue. A few semantic errors, such as type mismatches, can also be detected efficiently. However, accurate detection of the semantic and logical errors at compile time is in general a difficult task. The error handler in a parser has goals that are simple to state but challenging to realize. The error handler goals are report the presence of errors clearly and accurately, recover from each error quickly enough to detect subsequent errors, and add a minimal overhead to the processing of correct programs. Fortunately, common errors are simple ones, and a relatively straightforward error handling mechanism are sufficient. How should an error handler report the presence of an error? At least it must report the place in the source program where an error is detected, because there is a good chance that the actual error occurred within the previous few tokens. A common strategy is to print the offending line with a pointer to the position at which an error is detected.